Well, I am thrilled to be here today in the older youth category. And I am happy to work with amazing young people today and every day. It's why I can't help but think about not my just my own well-being or that of my daughter and the people I love, but people you and people all around the world, current and future generations. There's a lot of talk about sustainability. Yet climate sustainability is a fantasy without active repair. We can't sustain something that's broken. That's like trying to put something together permanently with duct tape or putting your finger in a dam to try to stop the ocean from pouring in. The negative impact of climate warming on humans, living beings, and the planet is an undeniable crisis. It's an existential crisis caused by humans, damaging the world's atmosphere. It's like a disastrous storm with countless known contributing factors. Things like fossil fuel use, deforestation, manufacturing, and massive overconsumption. And unfortunately, many well-meaning attempts to fix the solutions in one problem end up damaging the shores of another. The problems and the solutions are global and human. One thing that's puzzling to me is I keep hearing people don't really care about climate change. And yet we know that's not true. The largest survey of public opinion on climate change ever conducted tells a different story. The United Nations People's Climate Vote, covering 56% of the world's population in 17 languages, received 1.2 million responses in a short time from all genders, ages, social, and education backgrounds. And the majority of people said that they believe that climate change is an urgent crisis, and that's true in high, middle, and low-income countries, that they believe that their voices and concerns are being ignored and that policymakers are not taking enough action. And that all ages know this, but all ages also feel that they don't really know what to do about it themselves. And I understand, as dramatic as this is, how to get out of this crisis is not so clear for the general public and, unfortunately, for many policymakers as well. Although we can't become sustainable with systems that were broken, that are broken, we can become sustainable. We can find solutions working together. It will require interconnectedness on a global scale. And then we can move away from a battle of just attempting to sustain broken systems and onto the work of active repair. Repair fueled by dedicated optimism. You see, I'm a dedicated optimist, not to be confused with absolute positivity. I believe dedicated optimism means not pretending or denying that things are not okay when they are clearly not. Like, for instance, if my boat is sinking and I find myself treading in freezing water, it is miserable and I am not happy. But I am going to look for something to hold on to and I am going to adapt however I can to get to a safer place. It's that kind of optimism that led me to becoming an AI ethicist, dealing with the ethics of artificial intelligence. I went to an event and I sat next to somebody who said they worked on recommending ethical standards for AI. And I was curious, asked questions like, whose ethics? Asked many more questions, and eventually I was asked to join in. And having no previous background in technology, I was a little nervous, but I thought, well, AI is part of the future, whether I like it or understand it. So I decided that I could stand by and let development happen without me, or I could join in and perhaps contribute to shaping it responsibly. I got out of my own way, you know, that voice in my head that kept saying, you don't know anything about this. And I decided to learn. I had been working across sectors for decades in psychology, education, wellness, arts, social justice, organizational culture. And although those seemed completely unrelated, those have contributed to my work in ethics, technology, and now climate more than I ever anticipated. And I got deeply involved in the work and have helped recommend standards. And in that process, I met an extraordinarily diverse collective of people from around the world. And as the climate crisis has escalated, we have spent more focus on climate and technology, the ways that technology can contribute positively and negatively. Understanding that if we want current and future generations to survive and flourish and the planet, we would also have to do something about trying to help with repair. And it's turned into a kind of collective dedicated optimism. In this case, all of us together in the middle of a crisis, trying to get us all to a safer place. And we understand that there are many people around the world working on solutions, but too often they're working in silos. And I also understand that because the way a solution works in the sub-Sahara is not the same as how it works in South Korea or here in San Antonio. Yet even though one solution can't work for all problems, our efforts need to be connected, and we're not working together. Sustainable solutions must be connected. Goes local to go global. Because there's a ripple effect. What happens in one place eventually affects other places. So this is going to require many more people willing to connect, collaborate, and take action. People from every place on the planet, in all walks of life. I can imagine that world, a world where governments, communities, individuals, businesses, societies collaborate and become adaptive, a regenerative world where the earth is flourishing and the climate is sustainable. It's an amazing thought, isn't it? My dedication for this optimism has come from what I've learned about adaptive approaches. And if we combine regenerative design, transdisciplinary collaboration, and foundations of care, I believe flourishing is possible. Regenerative, to regrow, renew, or restore after damage or loss. So let's look at how regenerative design looks in ecosystems. These are holistic and co-evolving. Think of it like anthills or the rainforest or the human body, where the well-being of the whole system is reliant on the health of all of its parts. They thrive by focusing on the well-being of the whole system. And something we forget, or maybe we never realized, is that we are nature. Humans are part of nature, just like birds and trees and oceans. And likewise, regenerative businesses and societies and agriculture mimics nature, involving systems that are co-evolving for well-being, co-evolving by connecting people to place and natural systems, integrating nature and social sciences and technology. It's like circular cities, like Amsterdam or Bogota, or the indigenous villages in the Amazon, where everyone is asked to consider how their actions will affect everything else. And integrating all of this can be a challenge. So this is where transdisciplinary collaboration can provide incredible opportunities. And I know the term is most often used interchangeably with multi or cross or interdisciplinary, but let me explain how transdisciplinary is unique. Think of discipline as a way of thinking or practice. And this is a problem pot. Multidisciplinary is additive. So everyone stands around the problem pot adding a possible solution, but still staying in their own individual disciplines. Cross-disciplinary is perspective taking. Each person is going to try to look at the problem from the other discipline's perspective. Interdisciplinary is consensus making. Here, like a Venn diagram, everyone is staying in their own individual disciplines, but trying to identify a consensus. We all agree or disagree that this is the solution. And then there's transdisciplinary collaboration, a fusion, mixing everything in a blender, Here, all the disciplines merge together to create something entirely new, a whole greater than its parts, a regenerative system with shared leadership, involving as many disciplines or ways of thinking as possible. It decreases hierarchies, increases equity. For example, including people from the global south, like Somalia, a country that produces less than 0.01% of climate emissions, where drought and excessive heat killed more than 43,000 people. Or experiences of people from other places in the world most affected by climate change. Imagine the perspectives and knowledge that this would bring to problem-solving spaces that's most often left out. In governance, education, society, technology, business. Expertise in indigenous knowledge, social sciences, creative arts. What would happen if they were all at the table? So, what would motivate us to collaborate and be regenerative in these ways? A foundation of care. And I'm not talking about care in the way we think of it in traditional caretaking roles like nursing and childcare. I'm talking about care for global well-being to such an extent that people want to actually take responsibility for other people on the planet. Care is at the core of the most effective methods and approaches being used to mitigate climate damage. And care is needed in every aspect of life. Society, economics, governance, education, technology. 7 generations. 7 generations is a philosophy of stewardship practiced for centuries by many indigenous peoples around the world. It's based on the belief that we are all born with the same purpose, to be a good ancestor for 7 generations. A good ancestor, to wake up each day and say, what can I do today that will benefit generations to come? People I will never see. Our ancestors did that. We don't even know who they are, most likely. And if care is needed, understanding a lack of care is important, right? The underlying causes. On one hand, there's mindsets and behaviors that are driven by trends in valuing personal gain above all else. On the other hand, our natural human responses to crisis, to sensing that our basic needs are being threatened, fight, flight, or freeze, with feelings like fear, anger, fear, and sadness that lead to arguing, running away, or shutting down. And if lack of care is there, establishing a foundation of care is what needs to happen. Consider what you care about and the people you love. Really care about air quality, water supply, food and housing security, transportation, cost of living, quality of life, which are all affected, whether we know it or not, by excessive heat, drought, wildfires, storms, floods, earthquakes around the world. And then ask other people what they care about and the people they love. Make the connections. So how do we take care to taking action? Well, a crisis is a decisive moment in a story. A turning point for better or worse, requiring radical change. Human motivation in a crisis occurs when there are high levels of challenge, skill, and hope. If we can imagine and believe that we can deal with this crisis and adapt, we can meet these challenges of climate repair with optimism. Meet them with our unique human abilities, our minds, our creativity, our hearts, our ability to unlearn ways of operating that are no longer working, making room for new ways of thinking and operating. And it requires the 3 shifts. Everyone can do it. applying a regenerative design in our everyday life. Post notes. There are thousands of ways. Electricity use. Am I leaving my computer on? Have I left my lights on? Fossil fuel use. Did I just order 5 pairs of shoes from shipping that I'm going to actually try on and then ship them back again? What I wear, what I eat, what I buy, who I work with, what business do I have, what do I invest my time and money in, how I dispose of things. Engaging in transdisciplinary collaboration. Connect and collaborate with people, new people in new ways. Start a conversation with somebody you've never talked to before, just to hear their perspective. Listen to as many perspectives as possible. And build a foundation of care. Discover what you care about deeply and others care about. Remembering that solutions come from connections that lead to taking actions. From shopping locally to insisting that policymakers listen. Ask, what caring action can I take today? History and social psychology have shown us that having the courage to care is contagious. Many small actions can lead to transformation. Many small drops of water can change the shape of a stone. Remember that many more people in the world want to be part of the solution. Imagine if even half of them take action. Imagine that world. Take a moment. It's an amazing thought, isn't it? Thank you.